Hello friends, welcome to Engineering Today, and we're back with 4 space updates to share with you. We'll first talk about SpaceX successfully completing the launch of the Cargo Dragon 23 mission and also marking the 90th successful booster recovery. Then we'll talk about Amazon's request to the FCC to reject SpaceX's second-gen Starlink plan. After that, we'll give some updates regarding the failure of Astra's Rocket 3.3 launch. We'll end today with good support from agencies from Space Station Extension. On the 29th of August at 3:14 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time, SpaceX launched the Cargo Dragon capsule for the CRS-23 mission aboard their Falcon 9 rocket from LC-39A pad at NASA's Kennedy Space Center. This was SpaceX's 21st Falcon launch of the year. This time, the Dragon capsule carried more than 2,200 kilograms of supplies, scientific experiments, and hardware, along with an experimental new robotic arm for various tests. In the CRS-23 mission, SpaceX has used booster B-1061 for this mission. The booster has earlier supported 3 missions. Nearly 8 minutes after launch, the Falcon 9 booster B-1061 returned to Earth, landed on SpaceX's newest drone ship, a shortfall of gravitas, in the Atlantic Ocean, along with a smooth touchdown. The booster recovery also marked the 90th successful landing of Falcon first stage. During the launch webcast, Andy Tran of SpaceX said, "That's the 90th successful landing of an orbital-class rocket and the very first of our newest drone ship, a shortfall of gravitas. What a great way to start today's mission. The massive ship, called a shortfall of gravitas, will now return with the recovered booster back to port for future reuse." At present, the space station has another Dragon capsule docked with it. The docked Dragon capsule is the Crew Dragon spacecraft known as Endeavour. This Crew Dragon was launched on the 23rd of April and it had carried 4 astronauts to the space station. Thus, SpaceX will give us the luck to see 2 Dragon spacecraft docked with the station at the same time. Till now, this type of scenario is not too regular, but not rare, and with SpaceX's increasing speed, this scenario will surely become regular in the future. As we know, this mission was originally scheduled for the 28th of August. Weather officials of the Space Force's 45th Weather Squadron forecasted about bad weather situations, and the bad weather situation had made SpaceX teams finally scrub the launch. Joe Montalbano, program manager of the space station at NASA, said at a pre-launch conference, "We're sending up a good amount of fruit. We have lemons, onions, some avocados, some cherry tomatoes, and also some ice cream. That's a big hit with our crew." He also said, "Working with SpaceX and working with our other commercial providers has been just an outstanding partnership that we've established between NASA and the commercial industry. We're excited to launch this mission and get this incredible science to the station." Our next update is regarding Amazon's request to the Federal Communications Commission for declining SpaceX's amended Starlink plan. On the 18th of August 2021, SpaceX had proposed 2 potential arrangements for their future second-gen Starlink satellites. But Amazon had protested at that time, stating that it broke the rules of the regulatory agency, Federal Communications Commission, and they wanted amendment of SpaceX's plan before its filing. After that, SpaceX chose one of the 2 arrangements of the second-gen Starlink plan and put forth the application with some amendments. But Amazon has again protested this amended application, stating they're too extensive and projected. Amazon also stated that 2 filings of SpaceX also increase the future tensions of orbital debris and will increase the workload of operators. On the 25th of August, Mariah Schumann, corporate counsel for Amazon's broadband mega constellation venture, Project Kuiper, stated in a letter that, "Should the commission depart from its rules and precedent and endorse the approach of applying for multiple, mutually exclusive configurations, the consequences will extend far beyond the SpaceX amendment. However inefficient this strategy might be for the Commission and parties responding to applications, other prospective licensees will surely see the benefit in maximizing their optionality by describing multiple configurations in their license applications." She also asked the regulatory agency to dismiss SpaceX's amendment and invite SpaceX to resubmit its amendment after settling on a single configuration for its Gen 2 system. Our next update is regarding the failure of Astra's Rocket 3.3 launch. On the 28th of August, Astra had attempted to launch their Rocket 3.3 for the third time, but the launch ended in a failure. This launch was the first of two for the U.S. Space Force launches, which Astra got in a contract on the 5th of August. Particularly in this mission only, a test payload was planned to send in space to measure the launch environment of the rocket. And according to some reports, that payload would continue to be attached with the rocket in orbit. In the Pacific Spaceport Complex at 6:35 p.m. Eastern Time, Astra's small launcher LV0006 had fired its first stage engines, but there were many issues which caused large delays. After delaying for nearly 2 hours from the scheduled 4 p.m. Eastern Time, the teams had gone for launch. After ignition, the rocket tipped sideways rather than going upwards. After 20 seconds from ignition, the rocket started ascending upwards and continued to ascend for more than 2 minutes. Then the engines shut down and the rocket tumbled. According to some reports, the rocket had reached an altitude of about 50 kilometers before crashing into the ocean near Kodiak Island, and damage to the public was incurred. Chris Kemp, co-founder and chief executive of Astra, stated that one of the first stage engines had failed. He also said, "We're still looking into what happened. The guidance system was able to maintain control, and the rocket began flying horizontally for a few seconds until we burned off enough propellants to begin resuming with our liftoff." Kemp further said, "We collected a tremendous amount of data from the flight, and we have launched Vehicle 7 at the stage of production where we'll be able to incorporate everything we learned before sending it up to Kodiak and launching again." An earlier launch attempt was aborted for anomaly with engine ignition. Kemp commented that, "Right now, we have no reason to believe these are related." And regarding the sideways hovering of the rocket, he said, "We're still studying the data and looking for any fingerprints of that. We're incredibly impressed with the guidance system. Given that we had an engine that shut down so early into the flight, the fact that the rocket was able to maintain control and continue the flight and resume the trajectory was spectacular." This Rocket 3.3 vehicle had a number of critical upgrades, and Kemp said, "Making any changes to a complex system like a rocket always involves risk. We appreciate this, but also believe that maximizing our learning requires us to make advances and take appropriate technical risks." We'll wrap up today's updates with the space station extension having good support from space agencies and China becoming a strong competitor in space. On the 25th of August, at the 36th Space Symposium, NASA Administrator Bill Nelson said that he had good faith that Russia will have active participation in development of the International Space Station, and they will not end the participation for their own space station. Nelson said, "Despite what you read in the press, I think that the cooperation with the Russians, which has been there ever since 1975, will continue." He also said, "We expect our Russian partners to continue with us, and we expect to expand the space station as a government project all the way to 2030. At the symposium, Nelson also warned about an emerging space race with China. Discussions regarding extension of the International Space Station, or ISS, were also carried on. Extension of the space station has been long planned and put forth by Nelson, but that would require the agreement of the other station partners comprising Russia, Canada, Europe, and Japan. At the symposium, most of the officials of different space agencies supported the proposal. Joseph Aschbacher, Director General of the European Space Agency, said, "Personally, I would strongly support it." Walter Pelzer, head of the German space agency DLR, stated on the panel, "ISS is, from our point of view, tremendous infrastructure." He also said, "It has been and will be something that Germany will support as long as possible. We are happy that NASA is going in the direction of 2030. Regarding China, Nelson said, "Unfortunately, I believe we're in a space race with China. I would like, speaking on behalf of the United States, for China to be a partner. But China is very secretive, and part of the civilian space program is that you've got to be transparent." Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comments section. This will help us to improve.